What's up? Welcome to the courtroom.
I am Theo.
And I'm Oj. And in this podcast, we tell stories about people's life, liberty, and property.
Kukwentuhan namin kayo about court rulings in a way that will make you understand jurisprudence like a 9-year-old.
And first, before the Supreme Court of Appeals, just hear the attention of the court now in session.
So join us as we delve into true crime, political controversies, and all things tatay de chismis every week.
On June 29, 1991, at around 8:30 in the evening, Jessica Alfaro, together with her boyfriend Peter Estrada, was riding her Mitsubishi Lancer on the way to the parking lot of Ayala Alabang Commercial Center to buy shabu from Artemio Dong Ventura.
When they arrive, Ventura introduced the couple to his friends Hubert Jeffrey Webb, Antonio Tony Boy Lejano, Miguel Jing Rodriguez, Hospicio Pike Fernandez, Michael Gatchanyan, and Joey Filart. Sabi ni Jessica, madalas niya raw makita ang mga ito sa isang shabu house sa Paranaque.
Habang nagsashabu session ng mga ito, nilapitan daw ni Webb si Jessica and ask her if she can relay a message to a certain girl named Carmela Visconde. Pumayag naman tong si Jessica and so they drove to Carmela's house at Vincent Street, 700 Subdivision, BF Homes, Paranaque City.
Jessica and her boyfriend Estrada trailed after Filart and Rodriguez, who rode a Mazda pickup, while Webb, Lejano, Ventura, Fernandez, and Gatchalian rode on convoy the Nissan patrol car. Pagdating nila sa bahay ng mga Visconde, Jessica bust in, and when Carmela came out, she told her about Webb's message and that he was just around the corner.
Carmela was reluctant to go out though, since kakauwi lang daw niya ng bahay. Instead, she just asked the group to return 20 minutes after. Jessica relayed this instruction to Webb, who then told the group to drive back to Ayala Alabang Commercial Center to have another shabu session.
After some time, they drove back to Carmela's house. Sa ibang street, nagpark sila Webb and friends while Jessica proceeded to meet Carmela again. Nasa garden si Carmela nung dumating si Jessica. When Jessica approached her, she requested if pwedeng bumalik na lang ulit sila Jessica before midnight since aalis lang daw siya saglit. Iiwan daw niyang bukas yung pedestrian gate and yung iron grill papuntang kitchen nila. Di din daw ilalak ni Carmela yung kitchen door para makapasok agad sila Jessica mamaya. Sabi lang ni Carmela, mag-flasher lang daw ng headlights sila Jessica para alam niyang sila yung dumating.
Jessica then left the house and returned to her car. But since she was curious as to where Carmela will be going, she decided to wait for Carmela's car to leave and trail her. Nakita niya na may hinatid si Carmela sa Aguirre Avenue and was convinced that it was Carmela's boyfriend.
After that, she returned to her group and continued their shabu session. Jessica then relayed Carmela's instruction and kwento din niya na nakita niya si Carmela na may hinatid na lalaki. Na badrip daw bigla tong si Webb nang malaman niya. And when Webb decided that it was time for them to leave, he said,
"Ipilahan natin si Carmela. Akong mauna."
To which the others agree to the plan to gang rape Carmela.
They arrived at Carmela's house shortly before midnight. Jessica parked her car between Visconde's house and its neighbor. While waiting for the other to alight their cars, Fernandez approached Jessica and suggested na pasabugin na lang yung transformer para daw mag-brown out. Jessica shrugged the idea and told Fernandez that he's just high on drugs.
When Webb and his cohorts arrived, they once again affirmed the plan that they would line up to rape Carmela and that Webb would be the first one to do so. After which, pumunta na sila sa bahay ni Carmela. Before proceeding, Ventura loosened the light bulb para daw walang ilaw. Sinalubong daw sila ni Carmela and opened the aluminum screen door of the kitchen for them. Pagtapos, Jessica lost sight na daw of Webb and Carmela as they headed to the dining area.
At this point, Jessica decided to go out. When Lejano asked her when she was going, sabi niya magyoyosi lang daw siya sa labas. On her way out through the kitchen door, she saw Ventura pull out a kitchen drawer. She disregarded this and proceeded to the garden to smoke.
After a while, bigla na lang daw siyang may narinig na boses ng babae asking,
"Sino yan?"
Sa takot, she immediately walked out of the garden to her car kung saan nakatambay yung mga ibang kasamahan nila, and her boyfriend Estrada asked her if,
"Okay pa?
After some time, Jessica decided to return to the house. Madilim daw sa loob, but may konting liwanag na naaaninag from outside. Pagpasok niya sa kusina, Jessica allegedly saw Ventura searching a lady's bag sa dining table.
Nung tinanong niya kung anong hinahanap nito, he replied na,
"Ito nga dito, maghanap ka ng susi."
Nang tinanong niya para saan yung susi, Ventura adamantly said,
"Basta maghanap ka ng susi ng main door, pati na rin ng susi ng kotse."
Jessica eventually found some keys, but all of this did not fit through the main door. Defeated, she decided to return to the kitchen. While there, she heard a static television noise.
Out of curiosity, she approached the master's bedroom from where the noise came. When she peeked inside, dun na niya nakita si Webb na nire-rape si Carmela. And si Carmela laid with her back on the floor. Carmela was gagged, moaning, and in tears while Webb raped her, his bare buttocks exposed.
She saw two bloodied bodies on the bed, and Lejano at the foot of the bed about to wear his jacket. Webb saw Jessica by the door and gave her a meaningful look. She immediately left the room and met Ventura at the dining area. He then told her to prepare an escape as they were leaving soon.
Shocked with what she saw, Jessica rushed out of the house to the others who were either sitting in her car or milling on the sidewalk. She entered her car and turned on the engine, but she did not know where to go. At this point, Webb, Lejano, and Ventura came out of the house. Before leaving, Webb allegedly picked up a stone and threw it at the main door, breaking the glass frame.
Bago sila umalis, Webb told Ventura na naiwan daw niya yung jacket niya sa bahay. But Ventura told him na di na nila mababalikan yung jacket since nakalock na daw yung iron grills. Dali-dali naman silang umalis and drove away until the convoy arrived at a large house with high walls, concrete fence, steel gate, and a long driveway at BF Executive Village.
Pagdating nila sa compound, nagsimula ng magturuan ang mga ito. It was here with Jessica and those who remained outside learned about what happened inside the Visconde house.
Accordingly, the first to be killed was Carmela's mother, Estrelita. Then, Carmela's 7-year-old sister, Jennifer. And finally, Carmela herself after she was raped. Ventura blamed Webb, telling him,
"Bakit naman pati yung bata?"
To which Webb reply na nagising daw kasi si Jennifer and upon seeing him molesting her sister, she jumped on him and bit his neck and pulled on his hair. Doon na daw siya nagalit, so he grabbed the little girl and pushed her to the wall and repeatedly stabbed her.
At this point, Lejano excused himself to use the telephone in the house. Webb also called up somebody. At around 2 a.m., Gerardo Biong, a police officer, arrived. Webb then ordered him to go and clean up the Visconde house and said to him that,
"Uy lang yan, pera lang katupad niyan."
To which the police said, "Okay."
Webb spoke to his companions and told them,
"We don't know each other. We haven't seen each other. Baka maulit pa yan."
After that, Jessica and her boyfriend Peter Estrada left and drove to her father's house.
Gabi ng 30 ng Hunyo taong 1991, nang pasukin ang tahanan ng mga Visconde sa BF Homes, Paranaque. Pag-amin ng star witness na si Jessica Alfaro. Isa siya mismo sa 8 kataong nanloob sa tahanan ng mga Visconde noong gabing yun.
Actually, I was high on drugs, but with that, parang bumaba yung tama ako. Nagkaroon ako ng takot din.
4 years later, in 1995, the NBI announced that it had solved the crime and presented star witness Jessica Alfaro, who pointed out to Webb, Lejano, Ventura, Gatchalian, Fernandez, Estrada, Rodriguez, and Filart as the culprits. She also tagged police officer Gerardo Biong as an accessory to the crime.
Relying primarily on Jessica's testimony, on August 10, 1995, the public prosecutor filed an information for rape with homicide against Webb and company. The RTC of Paranaque, presided over by Judge Amelita Tolentino, tried only 7 of the accused since Bong Ventura and Joey Filart remained at large.
Impressed by Jessica's detailed narration of the crime and the events surrounding it, the trial court found a credible witness in her, especially because of her categorical, straightforward, spontaneous, and frank testimony, undamaged by grueling cross-examinations.
But in contrast, the trial court thought little of the denials and alibis that Webb, Lejano, Rodriguez, and Gatchalian set up for their defense. According sa trial court, they paled in comparison to Jessica's testimony that other witnesses and the physical evidence corroborated.
Thus, on January 4, 2000, after 4 years of arduous hearings, the trial court rendered judgment, finding all the accused guilty as charged and imposing on Webb, Lejano, Gatchalian, Fernandez, Estrada, and Rodriguez the penalty of reclusion perpetua and on Byong an indeterminate prison term of 11 years, 4 months and 1 day to 12 years. The trial court also awarded damages to Lauro Visconde.
On appeal, the CA affirmed the decision of the lower court. The accused then filed for a motion for reconsideration, but a 3-2 vote from the CA Special Division denied the motion. Hence, they filed an appeal.
On April 2010, the court issued a resolution granting the request of Webb to submit for DNA analysis the semen specimen taken from Carmela's cadaver, which specimen was then believed still under the safekeeping of the NBI. Kaso, it turned out that they no longer have custody of the specimen.
This outcome prompted accused Webb to file an urgent motion to acquit on the grounds that the government's failure to preserve such vital evidence has resulted in the denial of his right to due process.
Okay, Teo, balita ako maraming issues sa case na to eh. Ano ba yung mga yon?
Wala akong ganung nabalitaan. Siyempre, ang main issue dito is kung si Webb ba talaga at yung mga alleged alipores niya, yung salarin sa pag-rape kay Carmela at pagpatay dito. Sinama pa niya yung nanay ni Carmela na si Estrelita at yung 7-year-old na si Jennifer. Pero para masagot natin to, kailangan sagutin muna natin kung kapinipaniwala ba yung testimony ni Jessica or kung sufficient ba yung evidence ni Webb to prove his alibi and rebut Jessica's testimony.
May side issues din dito, right? Yung kay Byong, kung kinover up niya ba talaga yung crime? Saka yung sa motion to acquit ni Webb, kung dapat ba siya i-acquit outrightly since meron daw failure yung government to produce the semen specimen na nakuha ng NBI sa cadaver ni Carmela. And because of such failure, na-deprive daw siya ng evidence that would prove his innocence.
Sagutin na natin agad yung sa DNA issue, Oj. Sabi lang naman ng Supreme Court dito, hindi daw entitled si Webb to acquittal for the failure of the state to produce the semen specimen at this late stage. Firstly, na-overturn na daw ng bagong ruling yung ruling na sinight nila, yung Brady versus Maryland.
Sa new ruling, Arizona versus Youngblood, sinabi na yung due process does not require the state to preserve the semen specimen. Although, pwede namang maging useful to sa accused. Unless na lang kung mapakita na ang accused na may bad faith sa part ng prosecution or police. Saka pala, nung ni-raise ni Webb yung DNA issue, wala pang rule governing DNA evidence. Wala pa tayong technology dito sa Philippines para magawa yung test na yon. At wala pa din Philippine precedent on the admissibility of DNA as evidence.
Ito pa, nung dineny ng trial court yung application ni Webb for DNA testing, inallow niya pa din naman na mag-move yung proceeding kahit na meron siyang at least 2 occasions to challenge the alleged arbitrary action taken against them. Walang nag-file ng motion with the appeals court to conduct the DNA test pending nung decision sa appeal nila.
So, dahil nga daw may lack of interest yung accused in having such test done, the state cannot be deemed put on reasonable notice that it would be required to produce the semen specimen at some future time.
Yun. So, punta tayo sa merits ng case. Isa-isahin natin yung sinabi ng Supreme Court, Oj. Firstly, yung dun sa quality of witness na si Jessica Alfaro. Ano bang sinabi ng court dito, Oj?
Well, questionable nga daw kasi yung mismong witness since NBI asset si Jessica and yung way niya to earn a living is i-befriend yung mga criminals para maikanta niya sa mga NBI handlers niya. In short, she had to live a life of lies to get rewards that would pay for her subsistence and vices.
Kaya may question dito eh. Kasi diba, 4 years after nung incident, saka siya nagpakita at nag-testify about Visconde massacre. So, kaya ba siya biglang lumitaw after 4 years kasi nakonsensya siya? Or ngayon niya lang gusto itama yung mali niya?
Hindi naniniwala yung SC dito eh, Teo.
Bakit daw?
kasi may testimony din coming from Attorney Artemio Sakaging, former head siya ng NBI Anti-Kidnapping, Hijacking and Armed Robbery Task Force. Ikinantan niya din si Jessica. Talented niya daw kasi, ang dami niya ng nasuplong na kriminal. Kaya meron na siyang very special treatment from NBI and she became its darling. Kaya syempre, may mga privileges na siyang nakukuha sa pagiging informant niya.
So according kay Attorney Sakaging, one day unexpectedly, bigla na lang nagsabi sa kanya si Jessica na meron daw siyang kilala na alam yung real story sa Visconde Massacre. Nag-promise daw itong si Jessica na dadalhin niya sa NBI yung tao na yon. Kaso, hindi naman daw niya nadala kasi daw ayaw mag-testify. Kaya ang sabi na lang sa kanya ni Jessica na pwede naman daw niya i-assume yung role ng informant. Siyempre, hindi pumayag si Attorney Sakaging kasi di naman eyewitness nung si Jessica.
Take note, never ni-refute ni Jessica yung testimony ni Attorney Sakaging. So, syempre, may bearing yun sa Supreme Court.
Okay, so punta na tayo sa next point, yung suspicious details. Possible ba na makapagsinungaling si Jessica dun sa testimony niya? Eh, sobrang detailed daw nun, diba? Sobrang na-impress nga yung lower court. Tapos, yung ibang sinabi niya pa, nagtatali naman dun sa physical evidence sa scene of the crime.
Sabi ng SC, walang kaduda-duda na possible pa din na makapagsinungaling siya kahit super detailed yung testimony niya. Kasi sa media pa lang, makakakuha na siya ng details on Visconde Massacre. Tapos, everybody is talking about it pa. Kung ano yung nakita ng mga police dun sa scene of the crime. Tapos, ang dami pang speculations about them.
Ito pa, Marites, 'di ba? Darling nga si Jessica ng NBI at meron siyang privilege na tumambay-tambay sa NBI offices. So, malamang madaling-madali para sa kanya ma-access yung mga evidentiary details at documents concerning this case.
Lalo na meron talaga silang hinuli na mga akyat-bahay group sa Parañaque na charged initially for the Visconde Massacre. Syempre, yung police yung nag-prepare ng confessions nila and yung mga details from the evidence sa crime scene. Surely, alam din ng NBI handlers ni Jessica yung details. Kaya, alam mo na.
Dahil pati sa confessions na to na as per Makati REC, fabricated daw by the police to pin the crime on them, na-expose actually kung paano minamatch ng mga crime investigator yung details ng confession sa physical evidence. Ayan, nahuli tuloy sila. Sa full text ng case, merong mga facts na ang illogical and nonsense lang kung iti-take natin yung explanation ni Jessica.
Like dun sa smash door, as per Jessica, bago sila umalis, out of the blue, binato daw yun ni Webb. Eh di ba past midnight na nun? And they wanted to get away quickly to avoid detection. Tapos babatuhin ni Webb yung glass door. Eh di nag-cause yun ng ingay at narinig pa ng mga neighbors. So aside dun, meron pang ibang mga hinighlight yung SDA na wala lang sense kung iisipin.
Pati yung front door key na hinahanap nila, di ba? If you remember, nagahanapan sila ng susi ni Ventura. Ito daw yung reason ba't ransack yung bahay. Pero, ba't kailangan pa yung front door key? Eh, nasa loob na nga sila ng bahay, di ba? Saka yung garage light, para ma-off yun, di ba, nilusin nila yung light bulb. Sabi ni Jessica, umakyat pa daw si Ventura doon sa hood para lang ilusin yung light bulb and i-turn off ito. Ang risky lang kasi paano kung may makakita sa kanila, di ba? Walang sense kasi bukas na din naman yung kitchen door, so pwede naman silang dumire-diretso agad doon sa bahay, nag-exhibition pa din sa loob, di ba?
So, sabi din ng Supreme Court, star witness ng NBI itong si Jessica. And the NBI claimed that they had solved the crime of the decade. So, they had a stake in making her sound credible. Kaya, obviously, they gave her all the preparations she needed for her to be a fairly good substitute witness.
Kaso, ang tanong, matalas nga naman ba ang memory ni Jessica when it comes to faces that had a strong effect on her?
Not likely daw, sabi ng SC. Kasi, meron siyang sinasabing Miguel Ging or Jing Rodriguez na isa sa mga suspects sa Visconde killings. Kaso, nung may nahuli yung NBI na certain Michael Rodriguez, a drug dependent from Bikutan Rehab Center, kala nila siya yung sinasabing Miguel ni Jessica. So, hinarap nila to kay Jessica.
Ang funny nito, sorry. Alam ko yan eh, pagkakita sa kanya ni Jessica, pinagsasasampal at sinipa niya yung Michael. Sabi niya pa, how can I forget you, blah 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 blah. Kaso, it turns out, di naman pala yun si yung Michael Rodriguez na sinasabi niyang accused sa case na to. Di ba, parang joke?
Happy Halloween ba talaga to? Awit kay ate. Pero anyway, punta na tayo dun sa quality ng testimony. Sabi ng SC, you'll get a sense if nagsisinungaling yung witness eh. Kasi her story lacks sense or suffers from inherent inconsistencies. Para ma-expose yung lie, we need to understand the nature of things and the common behavior of people. And dito daw sa case, ang dami daw inconsistencies.
Number one, inconsistency. Sabi daw ni Webb, igagang rape nila si Carmela at nag-agree yung mga kasama nila. Pero nung nandun na sila sa bahay, sila Webb, Lejano, Ventura at Jessica lang naman yung pumasok sa bahay. Nagpaiwan yung iba sa labas, diba? If we remember, tatambay-tambay lang sila. So hindi consistent yung behavior nila dun sa gang rape plan that they all agreed.
First time lang daw ma-meet ni Jessica si Webb. Pero pumayag agad siya na utusan ni Webb na mag-deliver ng message kay Carmela. Tapos gas niya pa yung ginamit niya. Nagstay pa siya kahit nung nag-decide si Webb na i-gang rape si Carmela.
3. Nung pinuntahan niya si Carmela for the second time, sabi nito sa kanya na lalabas pa siya, so balikan na lang daw siya nila Webb and friends around midnight. Sinundan niya pa si Carmela hanggang Aguirre Avenue at doon niya nakita na may drinap off ng guy, si ate. Nakala niya jowa ni Carmela. Gusto mo yon? Nautusan ka na lang mag-send ng message, nakapag-spy ka na, di ba? Napaka ano ba to? Napakasipag, napakabait. Hindi ko alam kung mabait eh. Although, sabi ng SC, as a critical witness, malamang inimbento lang ni Carmela tong story na to para makapag-provide ng reason para mag-freak out si Webb.
4. The third time na bumalik sila sa bahay ni Carmela, siya or si Jessica daw yung nag-lead kaila Webb doon sa pedestrian gate na inopen ni Carmela. Ang weird lang kasi, ba't siya yung magli-lead? Kakakilala lang nila ni Webb tapos wala naman siyang role doon sa gang rape tapos siya yung parang tumatay leader.
Oo nga eh. Tapos, di ba, ang weird lang kasi manggagang rape yung grupo tapos nandun yung boyfriend niya, di ba? Tapos papayag ka. Anyway, 5. Paiba-iba daw yung emotions ni Jessica during that time. Merong natakot siya, tapos bigla siyang naging matapang, di ba? Natakot siya nung may narinig siyang boses, so lumabas siya, tapos maya-maya, lakas loob naman niyang sinundan yung TV sounds, di ba, if we recall. At pinuntahan nga pa nga niya si Webb nung nakita niya na may ongoing rape and yung mga dead bodies, tapos biglang na-shock siya. Parang ang daming emotional pendulum swings as per the essay, which indicates a witness who was confused with her own lies.
Eteo, how about yung other witnesses? Hindi ba sila nag-corroborate sa testimony ni Jessica?
Well, supposed to be. 6 additional witnesses ang pre-present ng prosecution eh.
Ah, si Dr. Prospero Cabanayan, yung isa sa mga pinresent nila eh. Siya yung NBI Medical Legal Officer who autopsied the bodies of the victims. Sabi nga niya, may mga stab wounds nga and the presence ng semen dun sa genitalia ni Carmela, indicating na ni-rape nga siya.
Next is si Normal White Jr. Siya yung security guard sa subdivision na nakakita daw kay Gatchalian and his companions. Pero di niya naman sila ma-identify, di ba? Pati yung vehicles na ginamit nila, di niya rin ma-describe. So as per SC, White's testimony cannot be relied on since inaccurate yung initial claim niya.
And surprisingly, hindi niya din napansin si Byong, yung police officer na pumasok at lumabas ng subdivision. Pati si Carmela at yung male companion niya na hindi din naman napansin. So, na-discredit lang ni White yung testimony ni Jessica about the movements of the persons involved.
Thirdly, si Husto Cabanaca naman, yung security supervisor ng subdivision. He also testified that he saw Webb around the last week of May or around the first week of June 1991. So, dinatry niya i-prove yung presence ni Webb sa Philippines since Webb claimed na nasa US siya. Pumasok daw si Webb ng subdivision at hiningan pa nga daw niya ito ng ID. Ang problema, wala siyang mapakitang log nung incident sa guardhouse book. Walang record ng entry si Webb dun sa subdivision.
Si Mila Gaviola naman, yung former laundry woman ng mga Webbs, testified na nakita niya si Webb on the morning of June 30, 1991. Dinescribe niya pa dito yung mga ginawa ni Webb that day, with matching time. Kaso, nung cross-examination na, tinanong siya kung ano yung naaalala niya on the other days 4 years ago. And apparently, she could not remember any of the details that happened in the household on the other days. Ang naaalala niya lang yung mismong araw ng June 1991, pero other days wala. So meron daw kasi siyang selective photographic memory, kaso that only damaged her testimony.
Gusto mo na may mili lang inaalala. So yun, next si Lolita de Berer, yung girlfriend ni Byong nung time ng Visconde massacre. Sabi niya kasama daw niya si Byong that time at meron daw talagang tumawag kay Byong around 2 AM. Umalis daw si Byong afterwards and umaga nang bumalik. Kaso as we recalled, wala namang napansin yung security guard na police investigator na pumasok at lumabas ng subdivision, ha? Given na 2 AM pa nun. So yun, diba? Kapansin-pansin naman pag may papasok at lalabas.
And lastly, si Laura Visconde, yung tatay and asawa ni Estrelita Visconde. He testified na meron daw nasabi sa kanya si Carmela na rejected suitor. She called Bagyo kasi anak daw ng politician. Unfortunately, Laura did not appear curious enough to insist on finding out who the rejected fellow was. Saka may contradiction daw sa testimony ni Jessica na nagsabi na in a relationship si Carmela and Webb.
So generally, meron daw missing corroboration, sabi ng SC, yung core theory ng prosecution na magjowa sila Carmela and Webb and that she had been unfaithful to him, and dahil doon sa unfaithfulness niya kaya ginang rape nila si Carmela, totally uncorroborated daw lahat ng mga yun.
Kasi wala man lang nakakaalam sa relationship nila, kahit sa friends ni Carmela, to think na anak to ng politician, ha, hindi niya man lang nakwento kahit kanino.
Tapos yung mystery man naman na drin-up off ni Carmela, hindi man lang siya lumabas nung namatay si Carmela and her family, as if hindi nag-e-exist yung guy na yon, yung guy na hinatid niya dun sa Aguirre Avenue, diba?
Ang mysterious nga, no? Anyway, yung alibi kaya ni Webb, kamusta naman?
Okay naman yung alibi ni Webb. As per the Supreme Court, among the accused, Webb presented the strongest alibi na nasa US siya during the happening of the incident.
Kasama pa nga daw niya yung tita niya, and may confirmation din from Raja Tours na they used and booked their flight to San Francisco. Nagkaroon pa ng despedida party with friends and neighbors noong March 8, 1991.
Aside from that, may stamp naman yung passport ni Webb by Ferdinand Sampol, yung immigration officer. He was also listed on the United Airlines Flight's Passenger Manifest.
Sa San Francisco, US Immigration recorded and confirmed yung entry niya sa bansa. On March 9, 1991, Webb presented all the pertinent documents authenticated by the Philippine Department of Foreign Affairs.
Meron din silang details nung stay niya sa US where Webb meet and encountered different people. May mga documents and public records din na nagpapakita na nasa US nga siya. Meron ding proof of purchase, traffic citation, receipts, etc.
And as evidence, he left for the Philippines on October 26, 1992. Dumaan ulit siya sa mga immigration checks, both the US and Philippine immigrations, on his return trip. So, confirmed naman yung departure niya.
Pero, ito nga yung nireject ng trial court and court of appeals. Weak daw yung alibi ni Webb since it cannot stand against Jessica's positive identification of him as the rapist and killer of Carmela, and apparently the killer as well of her mother and young sister. Kaya, fabricated daw yung denial ni Webb.
But as per SE, a judge must keep an open mind and must guard against slipping into hasty conclusion. A positive declaration from a witness that he saw the accused commit a crime should not automatically cancel out the accused's claim that he did not do it. A lying witness can make as positive an identification as a truthful witness can. Pwede niya sabihin na ginawa niya ang isang bagay without blinking an eye.
Kaya para maging acceptable yung positive identification, dapat ma-meet ng isang witness yung at least two criteria. First, dapat credible yung witness na nag-positively identify nung offender. Dapat mapagkakatiwalaan na magsasabi ito ng totoo. Usually, based to sa mga past experiences with that said witness. Her words has to one who knows her, its weight in gold. And second, believable dapat yung story ni witness, not inherently contrived. Walang mga inconsistencies or bewildering claims.
So, apparently, Jessica and her testimony failed to meet the said criteria. Hindi sufficient yung quality niya as a witness and her inconsistent, if not inherently unbelievable, testimony for a positive identification that abandons Webb's denial and alibi.
Ibig sabihin, may bearing yung denial and alibi ni Webb?
Kailangan ma-establish siya, and para ma-establish, dapat ma-prove ng accused by positive, clear, and satisfactory evidence that 1. He was present at another place at the time of the perpetration of the crime, and 2. That it was physically impossible for him to be at the scene of the crime.
Although, duda yung trial court and court of appeal sa accuracy ng travel documents like yung passport, as well as yung mga domestic and foreign records of departure and arrivals from airports. Possible daw for Webb kasi to secretly return to the Philippines after he supposedly left on March 1991. Tapos, he committed daw the crime, went back to the US, and openly returned to the Philippines again October 1992. Kasi 12 to 14 hours lang naman daw kasi yung travel time between US and the Philippines.
Pero sabi ng Supreme Court, if the court were to subscribe to this extremely skeptical view, edi wag na lang natin sundin yung rules of evidence at sundin na lang natin yung mga suspicions, surmises, or speculations as reasons for impeaching evidence.
Presumed true kasi yung mga documents na prinesent nila Webb, like yung passport or yung mga certifications. Hindi pwedeng basta i-claim na hindi totoo yun. Although yung presumption of truth naman can be overcome by evidence.
Kaso dito sa case, wala namang prinesent na evidence yung prosecution para mabaliwala yung entries dun sa passport ni Webb and yung mga certifications ng Philippine and US Immigration. Yung rebuttal evidence lang nila is yung fear of the unknown that is planted in the lower court's minds.
So, in short, nagwagi dito yung denial and alibi ni Webb. Ano naman kaya ang effect nito dun sa ibang accused?
Sobrang laki ng effect nito sa ibang accused, Teo. Kasi binabaliwala nito yung testimony ni Jessica. Not only with respect to him, syempre pati kala Lejano, Estrada, Fernandez, Gatchalian, Rodriguez, at Byong. Kasi if the court accepts na si Webb ay nasa US nung mangyari yung crime, hindi na mag-hold together yung testimony ni Jessica.
Oo nga naman, Webb's participation is the anchor of Jessica's story. Without it, the evidence against the other must necessarily fall.
In conclusion, in our criminal justice system, what is important is not whether the court entertains doubts about the innocence of the accused, since an open mind is willing to explore all possibilities, but whether it entertains a reasonable, lingering doubt as to his guilt.
For it would be a serious mistake to send an innocent man to jail where such kind of doubt hangs on to one's inner being like a piece of meat lodged immovable between teeth.
So, in the end, the court reverses and sets aside the decision of the Court of Appeals and acquits Webb and his co-accused of the crimes of which they were charged for failure of the prosecution to prove their guilt beyond reasonable doubt. And after 15 years of conviction, they were ordered immediately released from detention.
After the news broke out about the Visconde massacre in Parañaque City, the police arrested a group of suspects, some of whom gave detailed confession. The trial court thought it was framed up and eventually ordered for their discharge. Thus, the identities of the real perpetrators remains a mystery, especially to the public whose interests were aroused by the gripping details of what everybody referred to as the Visconde massacre.
If you guys like this audiogram, please listen to the full episode on Spotify or on your favorite podcast app, where you can hear our insights on this case. Again, this is Odge
and Teo, leaving you with a reminder to always look back in history, because precedent shall rule the future.
Thank you for listening, and we'll see you again in the courtroom.
Bye!